All right, so in this video, I'm going to talk about why you might not want to use controllers like the Johnson J-12 or the Digitech Control 1 in favor of a standard MIDI controller. And this video is in response to questions I had about a statement that I made on my website that recommends against the use of the J-12 and similar foot controllers. And I also did this because I tried to offer this warning on a couple of these YouTube demo videos talking about the controller, and the people who posted the videos deleted my comments, and one even sent me a less than stellar message. So I'm trying to give you the straight facts on the potential problem, offer you an alternative by letting you know it's okay to use a general MIDI foot controller with the MIDI in, and you can make an informed decision on whether you want to continue to use the controller. You also don't have to take my word for it. Spend about 15 minutes on a Johnson Amp internet board and see how many people have had damage occur in the way I'm going to show you, and it might help you make the decision. So if you have additional questions or complaints, feel free to post them in the comments. I promise I won't delete them, and I'll answer them, or at least, you know, engage in a healthy discussion with you. So here's the J12, and the automatic question is, well, why wouldn't you want to use these controllers if they were designed to work with the product? And it's potentially dangerous under certain circumstances, which I'll explain. And I'm actually going to do this using the schematic, which I think is the proof that shows exactly what I'm talking about. So here's the Control 1, and both these controllers are compatible with the Millennium, the 150 and 250, and then also with like the Digitech 2100 series, like the 2112 and the 2120 processors. So I used the Control 1 for almost a decade, no issues, and then it became unplugged by something out of my control twice on stage. The first time resulted in minor damage, and then the second time was serious damage that I was able to personally repair, but not everybody has that capability. So there's some internal connections that happen. And on the back of the Johnson, you have the MIDI in and out, you have the J3 foot switch, and then the connector for the J12. So along with two expression pedal inputs, these are all housed on a single PC board, and this is called the MIDI board in the schematic. And they attach to the main board through a ribbon cable and a multi-pin connector. So here's part of the schematic, and here are the connections that represent the ribbon cable. And we're going to focus on these connections, how they lead back to other components, and obviously centered around the foot controllers connections themselves. So there's a number of subtle warnings Johnson gives you, but none really tell you what happens if you don't follow them or you have some sort of accident. The warning on the amp tells you not to plug anything else into the jack, but nothing about unplugging during operation. And then the manual gives you two indirect warnings. There's a connection to the J12 should be made before the Millennium is turned on, and later in the document you see in parentheses, voltage is present at this jack. So we know that the foot controller hooks up using a 5-pin DIN, and 5-volt control messages run through this cable. So now the vacuum display on the foot controller, which is what offers you, you know, visual feedback in terms of patch change numbers, what effects you've turned on or off, that's powered by a second voltage that's sent out of the same cable. On the schematic it says 32 volts. I can't remember if this is true voltage or not because it's been a while since I actually cracked one of these open and worked on them, but this is where the hazard exists. So the simple act of unplugging this cable, either slightly or all the way, can cause a short across the pins and with the outer rim of the cable as a possible contributing factor. If your cable has a short in it, the same thing can happen. So if you do choose to use the J12, it's important that you always make sure that your cable is good. So if you remember the ribbon cable from the MIDI board, this is the connection where it connects to the main board. And you see this portion of the schematic, it's kind of the standard protocol for MIDI in and out with two main ICs, the 7404, which is a hex inverter, and then an opto-isolator, which prevents against damage from external equipment hooked up through the MIDI in and out, but not against what I'm going to show you. So let's look at what kind of voltage is wired to this jack. There's two 5-volt connections for logic and switching functions, and then there's the additional 32 volts, which supplies power to the display, as mentioned. So when you see things turn red on the schematic, this is where connections are happening. So imagine that the cable becomes disconnected or slightly disconnected. Pins are shorted together, because if you disconnect the cable, that's exactly what can happen. So I don't know if you ever did spark in the dark when you were, you know, a kid in science class. You get full of static electricity, you touch someone in the dark space, and then you see a little blue arc. And that's just static. That's not a live DC connection like what you have with the amp. So under the right conditions, you know, electricity can travel through, you know, short spaces of air, especially if there's humidity and other things contributing. So pins 6 and 7, those should be fine. Those go to chassis ground. It's probably part of the fail-safe to prevent damage in the event of a disconnect. It offers a path of least resistance going to ground, and it's not bad, but it's probably not 100%. So the next connection we'll look at is on pin 14, which also goes to ground, so some of this, you know, excessive voltage may travel there as well, but not likely. but let's focus on the simple problem. We can see that through a shorted connector or cable, 32 volts leaks onto a supply portion that normally only has 5 volts. Common sense. What happens when 32 volts hits components designed to handle 5 volts? Some of them, depending on their max ratings, can be damaged beyond repair, meaning you'll need to replace them. And if you look at the data sheets for any part I'm about to talk about, check the max voltage for either their inputs or, you know, VCC supply, you're going to see that 32 volts, and in a lot of cases, anything over the 5, 9, or 12 is going to damage these things. So if this overvoltage happens where you get this leak of 32 volts in the 5 volt supply, what's going to be damaged? Well, basically everything in this picture, but here's the biggies. So there's the Z80 microprocessor. It's essentially the heart of the amp's controls. Here it is on the schematic, and here's a 5 volt hookup. Dead. Okay. There's the EEPROM, which stores all the operating system and patch information. So here it is on the schematic. There's some 5 volt hookup, and guess what? Dead. And then there's the S-disk. Here it is on the schematic. You know, 5 volt power, some data busing. Guess what? It's dead. And as of 2010, there are no replacement S-disks available through Digitech, and odds are you're not going to find a loose functional S-disk on eBay or other parts sources. So in other words, if your S-disk gets damaged, that means your amp is done. So you can call Digitech. They have zero. I guarantee you, they have zero S-disks, no replacements. So the only way to get it is to scalp it from another working unit. This might be the tip of the iceberg as to what's damaged too. You also have other components like the special footprint and things that can potentially be damaged. So that should be enough, but if it's not, here's some more. So there's still pins 3 and 6 on the connector. Here they are. And where do they go? Well, 3 runs to serial transmit and 6 runs to the serial receive, both of these on the Z80 via the hex inverter that we mentioned before. So there's a possibility you're going to say goodbye to the hex inverter and maybe goodbye to the Z80 through this route, double whammy. And then what does the Z80 connect to? Well, directly to the EEPROM, and then these two buses. Here's the same buses on another page of the schematic, and those lead to the S-disk, which connect to the DRAMs. So ask the guys at Digitech, look at the internet forums. I mean, these are the major components that are damaged. And as far as replacement, here's what's available. Z80, you can still get them. Newer versions that might be compatible are still being manufactured. The EEPROM, you can still get the compatible parts. I have some blank ones, but you have to be able to flash them. And I do have the hex files, thanks to the guys at Digitech. I can email those to you if you want them. But you still have to find somebody to get those hex files onto the EEPROMs themselves. The DRAMs, you can still procure compatible parts or new old stock sites like eBay. But you have to find somebody who can properly remove and replace surface mount parts. And then the S-disk, it's not available other than, you know, scalping it from a working unit. The alternative is MIDI. You can use a general MIDI controller. It works exceptionally well with the amp through the MIDI in. This was the first amp that I know of that integrated, you know, had full MIDI implementation. But there's two drawbacks. Not using the foot controller makes the amp a little more difficult to program, but not by much. And the second thing is that MIDI continuous controller messages won't work as smoothly as built-in expression pedals on the J12. So things like wah-wah sound choppy or stair-stepped. But there's still two expression pedal inputs available for use on the back of the amp, so you can always plug in expression pedals to those. It essentially comes down to this. If there's no chance of your cable being unplugged on either end, like you don't play in clubs or bars where someone, and that includes a bandmate on stage with you, might step on it or do something to disconnect the cable, and you always make sure your cable's good, it's fine, it's safe. If that chance exists, though, that, you know, something's going to happen on stage or, you know, in a scenario where it might be unplugged, that's your choice whether you want to risk it or not. Just remember, if it's an S-disk that's fried, once it's gone, it's gone. So again, if you have additional questions or you want to complain to me or something, feel free to post them in the comments. I promise, again, I won't delete them. Or you can contact me through my website, which is bosleymusic.com.